Hello everyone. After we've created a linear regression model, it becomes really important to validate if the linear regression assumptions are met or not. One of the assumptions of linear regression is that there should be no autocorrelation in the residuals of your linear regression model, essentially implying that there is no lagged version of the residuals which is related to the residual itself. So how do we go about doing that? We have something called as Durbin Watson statistic. The Durbin Watson statistic is a test for autocorrelation in the residuals from a statistical regression analysis. The Durbin Watson statistic will always have a value of 0 to 4. How do we infer that if there is any autocorrelation in the residuals based on Durbin Watson test is what we look at in this video. So let's get started by importing the necessary modules. I have a file called as durbin_data.csv. which I load into my data frame df. Let's look at the total number of rows and columns in my data frame. As you can clearly see, I have 200 rows in my data frame and 4 columns. Let's move forward and print out the first 5 rows of my data frame. As you can clearly see, my data frame has 3 feature columns, which are x1, x2 and x3, and it also has a target column called as y. So it's a regression problem having all the features continuous as well as my target is continuous. Let's now separate x and y values, where x will contain the data of my feature columns, which are x1, x2 and x3, and y will contain my value of my target column, which in our case is capital Y. After we've split the data into x and y, let's proceed forward and split the data into train and test. I'll be using 70% of the total 200 rows in training and 30% for my testing purposes. Now, without doing much of EDA or pre-processing or feature engineering, let's go forward and fit a linear regression model. I'm using the stats models API to fit a linear regression model. After fitting the regression model, this is what I get. I get an intercept value of 2.70. For feature x1, I get a weight value of 0.04. For feature x2, I get a weight value of 0.199. For feature x3, I get a weight value of 0.006. We can also print out the OLS regression results, which is given by the stats model API, to find out how good or bad our model is fit. As my results suggest that the model has a very high R-squared value as well as an adjusted R-squared value, both having a value of close to around 90%, rather than spending a lot of time on this report, on which I've already created a lot of videos, I'll link the videos in the description section of the video so you can have a look at it. Let's jump on to something called as a Durbin Watson value, which in our case turns out to be 2.285. How is this calculated? What is the significance? What does it imply in terms of autocorrelation of the residuals is what we look at and try to derive it from scratch. So now let's spend some time in understanding the Durbin-Watson test. For any statistical test, you have something called as a null hypothesis and an alternate hypothesis. So in our case, the null hypothesis states that there is no autocorrelation of my residuals with any of its lagged versions. On the other hand, the alternate hypothesis states that there is a heavy autocorrelation of the residual series with its lagged versions. Now that the hypothesis statement is clear, let's go on to calculate the statistic value for Durbin-Watson test. Now you might be wondering what is this formula exactly. But to give you a simple interpretation of the formula, the value DW, which is the test statistic in case of Durbin-Watson test, is basically a ratio of the sum of squared of difference of residuals upon the sum of squared of residuals. So essentially, your numerator is nothing else but the difference of your actual residual values and the lagged version of one unit of your residual values. So essentially, this term, that is E of I minus 1, is your residual values itself with a lag of 1. So you take the difference of these two terms, square it, which gives you the numerator term. The denominator term is basically the sum of all your residual values. So essentially your residual values are nothing else but your observations minus the predictions, which is what is denoted by this formula. After you've computed the test statistic in case of Durbin Watson test, which would be stored into a variable called as DW, if the value of DW is less than a lower threshold value of DL, I reject the null hypothesis, which was that there is no autocorrelation in my residuals compared with the lagged version of the residuals. If my Durbin Watson test statistic is greater than an upper critical value called as DU, then I fail to reject the null hypothesis. There is also a case if your DW, that is if your test statistic, lies between my upper critical value and the lower critical value, then the test is inconclusive. So you can't reject the null hypothesis, neither can you fail to reject the null hypothesis. So this is that gray area which you have to keep in mind when you perform this test. If this idea is clear to you, let's try to compute these values from scratch. To compute the values from scratch, firstly, I'll make use of the model that I've created to find out the predictions on my training data set. Just a disclaimer, I want to come at a Durbin Watson value of 2.285, which has been computed for the training data set. So whatever I'm doing is essentially on the training data set itself. So I calculate y predict, which would be basically predictions of my x training itself using the model that I've computed. Let's also visualize the shape of my y predict. So as you can clearly see, it has 140 samples and my residuals are nothing else but my observed minus my predicted values. I save all my residual values into a data frame called as residual underscore df, and this is how my overall residual data frame would look like. It will have 140 rows along with one column, which is specified as EI, where each row is basically the difference of my actual value minus the predicted value. The next thing that I do is I compute something called as EI underscore square, which is nothing else but taking the square of your EI column. Now, if you go up, the calculation that I've done, which is EI square, is for the denominator term. So essentially what I do is I take the sum values of my EI underscore square column and save it into a variable called as sum underscore of underscore squared underscore residuals. So I run the cell and print out the value. So the denominator that I've computed, which is essentially the sum of squared residuals, is having a value of 347.10. Let's go forward and visualize the data frame that I have. So I have two columns at this stage. I have a column of EI and EI underscore square. The next thing that I have to do is I have to introduce a lag of 1 to my EI column in the residual data frame. So I run the cell and this is what I observe. So I've created a new column called as EI underscore minus underscore 1, which is basically the lagged version of my EI column. So this point, which was at location or index 0, has shifted to index 1. If I now visualize the last 5 rows as well, this value has disappeared in EI underscore minus underscore 1. And this second last value becomes the last value. Since I have the first row as an NaN value, I drop that row entirely. And now if I visualize the shape of my data frame, I'll have 139 rows. The next thing that was there in the numerator calculation is finding out the difference of the EI column and the EI minus 1 column. So I do this operation in this cell. Once I have the difference of EI and EI minus 1, I square that column and save it into a new column called as square of EI sub EI minus 1. And I visualize the data frame that I have. So now this column is of prime importance for the numerator sum calculation, which was computed by first taking the difference of EI column and EI minus 1 column and saving it into this column. Squaring this column gave me this column. So that's how I've been able to reach at the penultimate stage of my overall calculations. Now I have the column of all the square differences of my EI and EI lagged with a value of 1. Now all I have to do is I have to take the sum of these values, which is a fairly easy task in pandas. So I call the dot sum function, pass in the value of the column that I want to sum, and I save this value into a variable called as sum of squared of difference residuals, and I run the cell. So the numerator term, which is sum of squared of difference residuals, has a value of 793.31. Now the test statistic that I mentioned is basically the ratio of numerator by denominator. So when I run the cell and when I kind of visualize the value of the test statistic, it turns out to be 2.285. Let's go up and validate if the value is correct based on our calculations. So we are chasing a value of 2.285. If I go back up and if I validate it against this value, I get the same exact value that is given in the stats model API report. So we've successfully implemented a Durbin Watson test from scratch using pandas. But the story is still far from over, because we have to also validate whatever value we are getting. Does it imply that our overall residuals are non-correlated, or are they autocorrelated? For that, we'll have to make use of something called as the test table. So as I've already mentioned, you have the upper critical value DU, you have a lower critical value called as DL. Where do you find it? How do you find it is where the Durbin-Watson table comes in handy. So I'll switch over to a PDF which kind of has the table ready. I'll also link that table in the description section of the video, so you can have a look at the PDF file as well. So this is the Durbin-Watson table that I was mentioning sometime back. Now, how do you find out the values of DU and DL, that is your upper critical value and the lower critical value? So if I keep going down, I'll start seeing a table like format. So this is the table that I was mentioning. So you have something called as K mentioned here, K equal to 1, K equal to 2, K equal to 3, and so on and so forth. And you have some numbers N here. K basically signifies the total number of features that are there in your overall linear regression model. So as you can clearly see, whatever I've just mentioned is again validated in the PDF itself, where K is the total number of regressors excluding the intercept term. So if you remember, we had three features, x1, x2 and x3. So we'll only be looking at K equal to 3 column for finding out our upper critical value and lower critical value. Now we have finalized the column, now we have to finalize the row. Now N is the total number of samples that are considered that you're testing for. So in our case, we used our entire training data set to come up with that value of 2.28. So our training set, if you remember, consists of 140 samples. So I'll go down and I'll pick 150 since it's closest to 140. So the lower critical value at N equal to 150 is 1.584. And the upper critical value at N equal to 150 for 3 regressors is 1.665. The statistic value that we computed was 2.28. Our lower and upper critical values are 1.5 and 1.6 respectively. So our statistic value is greater than our lower and upper critical value. Let's go back to the hypothesis that we framed. I again repeat, since I've changed screens, the lower critical value was 1.5 for N equal to 150 and K equal to 3. The upper critical value, which in our case DU, was around 1.6 for the same set of combinations of N and K. And the DW that we calculated was 2.28. So essentially DW is greater than DU. So I failed to reject the null hypothesis, which states that there is no autocorrelation of my residuals with any of its lagged versions. So this is a good linear regression model that I've constructed, which does not violate the autocorrelation assumption of my residuals. Now that we've proven this statistically, we can also validate this by using the ACF plot or the autocorrelation plot. So So as you can clearly see from this autocorrelation plot, if I have my residual values as it is, and if I keep taking a lagged version of my residual combinations and try finding out the correlation, this is what I find. There is no significant autocorrelation or correlation of the actual residual series with any of its lagged series. So this was my attempt at explaining how Durbin Watson test works internally and how you can use it smartly to validate your linear regression assumption of autocorrelation of residuals. I hope you found this video informative. If you do have any questions with what we covered in this video, then feel free to ask in the comment section below and I'll do my best to answer those. If you enjoy these tutorials and would like to support them, then the easiest way is to simply like the video and give it a thumbs up. And also it's a huge help to share these videos with anyone whom you think would find them useful. Please consider clicking the subscribe button to be notified for future videos. And thank you so much for watching the video.